Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Twa Teams One Street. I'm Tom Duthie, and podcasting alongside me today are George Cran.
Hello.
Alan Temple.
Morning.
And Graeme Finnan.
Hello, everyone.
Dundee first today. Well, there's something we won't have to say for the rest of this season. Dundee-ish. George. I was looking just before I came in this morning. I mean, I don't like to be depressing, negative, grumpy. But I keep reading, top six is still on. They've won once in their last eight games. Six times this season they've been ahead and not won the game. Mm-hmm. This is not the form of a team heading for the top six. And a team that I still say should be concentrating on cementing its place in the league in its first year back. Discuss, yeah. George, discuss.
Well, on that front,
I'm worried.
Yeah, no, I'm looking more at the team has to stay up in the division, and they've got a healthy gap over bottom, which is always a good start. 4 points over 11th place as well. At this stage of the season, Dundee, over the past few years, tend not to be in this sort of position after the first half of the season. But there's definitely issues to be ironed out. As you say, one win in eight. That win was that 96th minute winner at Ross County, so it mm-hmm. could easily have
ended. You're more depressing than me.
But there was other games they could have won as well. They've lost their way a wee bit. Obviously, lost one of the best players in Owen Beck, but they've a lot of injuries, new faces coming in. There's just feel like a kind of team in transition at the moment, that Tony Docky's trying to figure out what his team actually is right now, because I was having a look at the defence that he picked at Kilmarnock, which surprised quite a few people. But there's obviously reasons for that, injuries and stuff. The first half of the season, his first choice back five, the only one that was there was Joe Shaughnessy, mm-hmm. including the goalkeeper, the back three and the two wing-backs. McGee was there, but he was, instead of his usual right wing-back, he was a centre-back. So they based a lot of their success in the first half of the season on being really solid defensively, picking up clean sheets, and they've not got that defence at the moment that served them so well. And I think that's affecting them more than maybe expected.
Yeah, that's the other thing I was going to say, Bear. The stats say seven goals conceded in the last three games, but in terms of minutes, it's just over two games. I think it was in the last 15 minutes mm-hmm. or so in Kilmarnock, they lost two goals just before the break. Mm-hmm. They do need to be more solid, don't they?
Yeah, of course they do. And you look at their goal difference now, and it's up to -7. And for a while, Dundee were sitting around sort of -1, -2, which is a good place to be for a team like Dundee. They'll have let it slip a wee bit. And as George has pointed out, the personnel changes probably hasn't helped that. The game against Hearts, I've got to say, I'm not going to blame the defence for that. I mean, it was a second half collapse, but it wasn't entirely down to defence. The defence was put under a ridiculous amount of pressure, the centre backs and the goalkeeper, because the ball continually kept coming back at them from either side. And that was purely down to the fact that Dundee just couldn't keep the ball when it was up top, when it was in midfield. First half, they were great. There was a lot of nice triangular stuff. They kept possession, they broke forward. But from the moment Luke McCowan went off, they seemed to lose it a wee bit, and Hearts just came forward and drove. Now, we've seen that when they play Celtic and Rangers, and Celtic and Rangers can do that to you. You just don't get a chance to get out your box. But against Hearts, you would expect Dundee to be better. And I would think Tony Docherty had a word with quite a number of the players. Didn't do enough to retain possession when Dundee were under the caution, but mm-hmm. they could have done much, much more. And, you know, he made, I think it was about five changes for the game against Hearts. I wouldn't be surprised to see another five changes against Livingston on Saturday, Tom, because there'd be a number of boys he was not happy with. And I'm sure, although he came out in the press afterwards and spoke to the media afterwards and was, you know, he was quite complimentary about his team's first half showing, certainly. I'm sure in the changing room he was much more vocal in how they performed in that second half than left them, and no sort of thinking that, you know, that was a poor second half performance and they need to improve.
Why is Alan Temple laughing?
Because
other than his United allegiance.
No, don't be silly about that. Having covered Hearts for quite a long time, I can tell you just how close the dressing rooms are to the press room. It's just kind of down the corridor.
Yes,
so
you hear.
From feedback, and not from George, I should say, absolutely not from George, but from feedback from a couple of boys that I know that were in that press room, I don't think Tony Docherty was calm in the dressing room, but saying all the right things afterwards, so that's good management, isn't it?
Yeah, and it's that thing. I do sound depressing, but you can't get away from them. They'd be delighted in terms of points with where they are, just now. But it's you're delighted with it. Even I saw the Kilmarnock game last Saturday. Once they'd lost the game in the first 3 minutes, they actually didn't play badly.
No. Mm.
Never looked like scoring, to be honest. First half on Tuesday night, they might have snuck a third just before half time. But the other side of that's the lapses. I mean, the second half at Tynecastle seems to have been all one-way traffic. Not just that the defence were having to deal with balls into the box all the time. It was balls into the box from good areas. Mm-hmm. They weren't even, forcing Hearts deep or hurrying them or something like that. It all seemed to be measured passes and crosses in the final third. And now any defence is going to struggle.
Yeah.
Not to concede over a 45-minute period like that.
I've got to credit Hearts for that, the way they played. I mean, there was good movement.
Yeah, there is the Tynecastle factor too. If the crowd get up and Hearts get on top of you, it's hard to get out.
But you're right, they shouldn't be getting down the line continually. The ball shouldn't be coming back continually. And it just wasn't good enough from Dundee. I'll say honestly, the front two have got to keep the ball much better. And in midfield, they've got to keep the ball. And there comes a time when you've got to put your tackle in as well, Tom. Mm-hmm. And there wasn't. I think Dundee are missing that in midfield. You know what I mean? I was surprised that Mo Salah didn't get a chance. I'm not picking Tony Docherty's team for him, but I thought he did quite well.
He wins the ball back.
I thought he was a man to come on when things started looking as though they were getting a bit tougher. Disappointing for a first goal. I've got to say, I don't know what Lyle Cameron's doing.
He's guessed
the guy's going to pass and stepped out of the way. To be fair, it was a terrific finish. And then the second goal, Dara Costello is a mile off his man at the back post and makes it easy. Third goal takes a bit of a deflection, I've got to say. But we spoke before coming on air, Hearts could have scored a few more in that second half. So I think Hearts probably ran a deserved one, I would say. Dundee could have been a wee bit unfortunate when Boateng goes through and he's bundled
clearly to the outside the box.
That's clearly.
I have to say, I was sitting when I saw those incidents. I feel sorry for whoever invented VAR, because VAR's not the problem. Yeah. It's the people that are looking. The penalty that Carson makes a brilliant save.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where on earth is there a penalty there?
Yeah.
And then the penalty that was awarded to Dundee. You can see daylight between the tackle and the line, and you're like, who's giving a penalty there?
Yeah, I know. So, both wrong, but at least they got the right call on the Dundee one.
Unfortunately.
You'd have preferred they got the wrong
call.
Yeah, you're right, Job.
Two wrongs might have made a point.
we could have got something out of that. But I'm just looking at Dundee's run here, okay, and we've been talking about them coming back after the break, bit of transition, but Dundee have been on an incredibly tough run. You look at since the start of December until the end of January, by my reckoning, they'll have played 9 games by the time they play Aberdeen. 8 of them will have been away from home. Mm-hmm. And the one game that was at Dens was against Celtic. Now, that obviously is down to the fact that Dundee had 2 games called off at Dens Park because of the elements. Yeah. But it doesn't give you a real opportunity to pick up a head of steam, a bit of momentum. Mm-hmm. So I think Dundee, looking on the positive side, they've done all right to keep themselves where they are. There are concerning signs there. I think you can't put it down to the personnel changes that they've made. But I would trust the first half performance at Tynecastle was good. For 70 minutes at Kilmarnock was good. But they need to do the important things better.
Yeah.
You can't ship goals in this league. That's the worrying thing for me. Are they going to start being a team who look like they look fragile every time the ball goes in the box? And at Tynecastle in the second half, they were.
You mentioned Cameron, and I think we saw kind of where he's at in terms of on Tuesday night, because it was a great finish for his goal, and it kind of showed he's we all know his quality on the ball, but defensively I think he's still learning, certainly Premiership level. There was a few times where the ball just got past him too easily, and I think that's certainly something that's where he needs to, if he wants to become a really top Premiership class player or go down south, he really needs to.
We've spoken about the fact that to play Lyle Carman, you really need a bit of experience around him, somebody to take the weight. And no disrespect to Boateng and even Josh Mulligan, they are not at the stage of their careers where they take command of a game.
Yeah.
You need somebody who can get on the ball, make tackles, and you know, do the job.
And you go
for
back to the, what I mentioned there, the Tynecastle factor.
Yeah.
Even when you're playing well at Tynecastle, you can be under the cosh. Now, the fact that Dundee have got an experienced goalkeeper, experienced central defenders, these guys were too busy doing their own job. To me, it was crying out for experience in the midfield to help the kids out, because they're all these kids that were involved at Tynecastle, great footballers, but there's another side to the game, and that's the side you have to learn.
So, well, Tony Docherty kind of said that after the game. Obviously, it's too late by that point, but he said that a lot of them hadn't played at Tynecastle before, and that was maybe a factor. So, I mean, he's been around the game a long, long time, but he's still learning, being number one, making all the calls. So I think we need to remember that as well, that he's a very new manager.
I think you have to say, in fairness, credit to Hearts too, because the Tynecastle crowd gets on top of the team that's losing. They can get on top of their own team, and by half-time on Saturday, they'd be right on the backs of their own players, and it takes a bit of character for them.
I think that'll be the really disappointing thing for Tony Docherty, because knowing Tynecastle quite well, that atmosphere will have got incredibly toxic. I mean, George was there.
Naismith said that word.
It would have remained so. You know, this notion that the crowd somehow inspired the performance, with the best will in the world, they don't really do that at Tynecastle. The crowd would have remained toxic the longer that game went on, and it's Dundee, by allowing Hearts to get back into the game, that have snowballed that effect. So I'm sure the crowd and the atmosphere and the Tynecastle factor was relevant by the end of it, but it's Dundee allowing Hearts back into the game that has sparked that, because otherwise that crowd factor would have gone the other way the longer that game had went on like that, and it would have been a really nasty place for Hearts to play their football if maybe Dundee had just held out maybe another 10-15 minutes longer and it had approached the closing stages. So that'll be a big frustration, because they did that so well in terms of frustrating the home crowd and playing well in the first half, to have completely
failed
to do that.
Two cracking goals as well.
Yeah. I was actually just going to ask, speaking of the difference between players that are doing well attacking and defensively, the Dara Costello signing, I was watching the highlights and he did so well for that second goal Lyle Cameron's goal, and then as Bear's pointing out, the defensive side of it, just is he going to continue at wing back? Is that his best position, or is that going to be a problem?
I don't know. I don't know whether it's a kind of forced into it at the moment, because Tony Docherty doesn't seem to want to particularly change from his 3-5-2, which has worked really well in the first half of the season. But he's not got Owen Beck, and he was a big part of that, trying to figure that one out. Costello's obviously come in. We can see he's obviously more suited to being an attacking player, and he's kind of said he's happy to play anywhere, but he sees himself as a winger forward type. And I think he's been fine on the ball. He was sent in a lot of dangerous crosses at Cremorne. I think there's certainly looks like a player that'll be useful to Dundee, but there's certainly better going forward than he has been defensively, and particularly places away at Kilmarnock, away at Hearts, you need to sit in and defend at times, and I think he's certainly learning that. It was interesting at Kilmarnock actually, because Dundee's wing backs were both kind of attacking, or Ryan Howley played on the right, he's usually centre mid. Kilmarnock played two wingers as their wing backs, so the two both sides were making hay down attacking wise down the flanks, but defensively were really struggling.
What I'm about to say, I qualify with the fact it's own fault, because they're the coaches and they teach them, but I'd hate to be a manager in the modern game looking for a young, strong defensive fullback or wing back, because it seems to me the defending side of the game, they seem to learn when they're in the first team, because they're all the fashion is attack. The fashion's Andy Robertson, Trent Alexander-Arnold. They all want attacking players that get up the park, and the bit that seems to be missing certainly in their early years, is always the defensive side.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's interesting the way the game's evolved. I mean, I think back to when Gary Neville was considered one of the best fullbacks in the world. Yeah. Gary Neville would be considered dull as dishwater in the modern game, like Christian Panucci playing for Italy again, all defensive, whereas totally different game now, isn't it? It's completely, I think, Cafu's got an awful lot to answer.
It's all his fault.
Dundee had a Cafu of their own for a while, didn't they?
Yes. I think sometimes, Tommy, results can change a manager's thinking, and the way Dundee have conceded in their last couple of games, does Tony Docherty now give up some of that attacking prowess? Yeah. For, and to look more on the defensive side, so he might look to someone that is more certainly on the left hand side, somebody is a bit more defensive in that situation. It will take away from going forward, but they'll have to stop what's happening.
Yeah, I think that the other Owen that they've signed, Owen Dodgson, I think he's maybe picked for that that slot, because he is a defender, but he's played that wing back role, and he looks pretty good in the ball from what we've seen. That quite liked what I saw on Tuesday. Still got a fair bit to learn, I would say, but the knock-on effect has been that Ricky Lamy's missing, and I think they've really missed Ricky Lamy, and Portales is missing, and there's somebody else I think who's
telling us they're missing. tell us they're back.
Well, we'll find out this afternoon if any of them are back, hopefully. As I say, I think Ricky Lamy has been a big miss. I think we're seeing the effect he's had on the team since he's been out of it.
He's quite a calming influence, Ricky Lamy, isn't he?
He's an experienced defender.
He makes half things look simple. He doesn't get himself into situations that look awkward. He just does the job. And obviously,
Portales has done well too.
Yeah, Portales has been fit. I mean, we spoke last week about Lee Ashcroft, and Lee Ashcroft's come in and played the last two games. I feel sorry for him, because I don't think he's done too much to be perfectly honest, but he's been on the losing side twice, and that's what people will look at Ashcroft's back, and we've lost two games, but I don't think he's done too much wrong.
No, but I do think Ricky Lamy, I think we've seen this season that Ricky Lamy's maybe a step ahead of him at the moment, but he's got that hamstring issue at the moment.
I mean, even for all we've said, I totally understand. It must be difficult for a manager when you've got the young, exciting, attack-minded talent in that area that Tony Docherty's got, that when you say, well, it's time to take him out, and you've got two or three options of the same kind of exciting player. I mean, it's hard to condemn a manager for wanting to put out on the park players that fans love to see. But sometimes, I mean, one thing that sort of crossed my mind in the wake of Tuesday night is, There's a great foundation, more than a foundation, at Dundee just now to build on. But they have to be doing, they can only build on it in the summer if they're still in the Premier League, and that's, to me, has got to be the priority.
Yeah, I think, you know, I think sometimes you've got to try and relax, you know, when you're in a situation like this. I've started the season really well, as George mentioned right at the start of the podcast. It's a situation they've not been in for a long, long time, where they find themselves in mid-table, well away from the foot of the table, a points gap to the team that's in 11th place, but they've got to keep picking up points. That's what I've always said. Dundee teams in the past have gone on runs that have been horrendous, and have taken them either relegated them at this point in time in the season, or have taken them right into the mix. We don't want to see that. I don't see that coming. The way they're playing, the way they're set up, the game plan was perfectly executed in the first half at Tynecastle. But games last 90 minutes, and we've seen this season with Dundee, they've struggled to put 90 minutes together. We've seen games, I go back to the Motherwell game for Park, they were brilliant in that first half, allowed Motherwell to get back in. And there's been other times throughout the season where they've really struggled. And that could be down to the fact that they've got a lot of inexperienced players in the side. When things start going wrong in games, they've not got a settling period where they go, okay, you're not going to get your own way for 90 minutes against any team. But see, when you've not got, the other team's got the upper hand, let's just make sure that we sort of make this life as difficult as possible for them. And that didn't happen against Hearts at Tynecastle.
Jordan McGeer said that after the game. It's in the paper today, talking about being kind of streetwise. And when that first goal goes in, you just have to try and calm things down and not let it go away from you, and they kind of allowed that to happen.
And ironically, after throwing the game away in those first few minutes at Kilmarnock, they did that quite well. Once they got over the disastrous start and they settled down, Kilmarnock didn't have many chances.
No.
In that game, but the game didn't need to. The game was won.
I honestly thought that if they'd got to go back, they could have been on and won that. Actually,
which
won
they
the game.
Seemed to do. And only the referee knew why it wasn't.
Yeah,
I think it was offside. But
yeah, it was one of these ones. Yeah.
If VAR was in place, which it could have been, the teams could have used it if they wanted to. But
I've got to say as well. I mean, we'll speak about Adam Lexton's. He gets back in and finds himself losing two goals in the first couple of minutes. Now, I think he was probably culpable for the first one in terms of he wasn't sharp enough off his line to get there.
Yeah.
I heard Dundee fans criticising him for the second one. I'm not so sure about that.
Exposed,
you've got to win the header in the box in the first one. But I really felt for him going off because he's not played for 6 months and here he is going off after sort of 30 odd minutes. He obviously has a problem with his vision. I knew there was something up. You know, his head was down, and I felt for him.
Because
he's been a big part of Dundee over the last. Yeah. I mean, I can remember him going down to Kilmarnock and being part of the team that won down there in the playoff. So I hope that's. I hope he gets another chance at Dens, but I hope that's not the way he ends his Dundee career because he deserves better than that.
I would echo that as well. You could see. I think the subs were coming in and asking if he was okay and stuff like that. You could see there was something not quite right. I certainly hope to see him Dundee shirt again. But Trevor Carson's number one, I think.
Deservedly
so. And hey, guys, look on the bright side. One thing, I mean, for all my doom and gloom of a few minutes ago, and I'm not pretending I'm not worried about Livingston on Saturday, but 3 points at Livingston on Saturday, even I would say bottom's out of the picture now.
Yeah, I would say that.
It's a big prize this early in the season.
Big opportunity for Dundee to go and do that. I think you're right. 3 points on Saturday, Livingston certainly aren't going to catch them. And I think, I'll be honest with you, every other team, I'm sorry David Martindale, but every other team that are in the bottom half of that table will be hoping Dundee go and take 3 points against Livingston on Saturday. But they beat Raith Rovers last week, so they've taken a bit of heart from that. Mm-hmm. So we need to be cautious. But I think Dundee have got, they're putting a good performance here the last time at Livy. Bit of a sort of first half was Eeksy Peeksy, but Dundee stepped it right up in the second half and ran out deserved winners. Could have won by more, I think it was two. Interesting again to see what sort of lineup he puts out after the midweek performance. I'd expect changes, but it's a great opportunity for Dundee. The pressure is all on Livingston, Tom. The pressure is all on Livingston. They've got to get a result there.
It's actually amazing Livingston aren't more out of the picture when you look at that league table. Mm-hmm. They've won two games in 21, yet they're still only 6 points off potential safety. It really is remarkable. And you do, I don't know if you were one of the teams around them, you'd be worried about the fact that Livingston haven't had their... Every team tends to have a wee run, a wee bounce at some point, and Livy in particular, that would be a very Livy thing to do. They've tended to do it in most seasons. So I'd be slightly worried about just how not completely adrift Livingston are at this point.
That kind of happened with St Johnstone as well. They were absolutely awful at the start of the season and they'd never really got cut adrift too much. But I think the games against Livy for Dundee have been quite strange this season. They've won both games. They were much better than them at Livingston, I thought. And then Livingston came and played really well at Dens and looked the better team in the first half, and Dundee eventually saw that game out with Luke McCowan.
A wonderful free kick, wasn't it? Yeah.
They need him to be playing, I think, on Saturday. Mm-hmm. I think it's just been far and away that Dundee's best player.
It showed during the week how much he's come on, Tom, because we spoke before about the consistency. Luke McCowan is a big, big player for Dundee. Now, he doesn't lose possession.
Bear, we spoke so much about that consistency, we want a cut of his £5 million transfer that will come in the next couple of years.
I'm hoping he's fit for Livingston, that's for sure. I mean, Tony Docherty said it was precautionary.
I think he was feeling a bit of
tightness there. So, fingers crossed he can play.
And I mean, one thing, for all it could be a big win for Dundee, one thing they know, Livingston in general, but also Dundee have done it to themselves. Livingston and every other team are going to say now, keep going. Doesn't matter if they're ahead, doesn't matter if they're playing really well, keep going against Dundee.
That's what happens.
Because you might, and it does. And that'll be, you know, that'll be a feature of team talks.
Yep.
Or a half time if the opposition are 1-0 down, you know the opposition manager and senior players are going to be saying, keep going, because they'll give you a chance. And that's maybe puts extra pressure on Dundee.
It does a wee bit, but Dundee need to get that out of their system. Yeah. I mean, they've got enough clean sheets this season to suggest that they've got players there that can get back to, you know, keeping it tight. And I, like I say, I'm not going to blame this. Sometimes you, when you lose goals, you can pinpoint it on the defence in the centre. But I would say that's not their problem.
No.
It is more coming from the wide areas and in front of the defence. Who's blocking the shots? Who's stopping the runners, etc., etc. So they've got a bit of work to do defensively, but Tony Docherty will have that drummed into them. There's absolutely no doubt they've been working on it from Tuesday right through to Saturday's game. That's one thing, part of their game they'll be working on. And heaven help the person who doesn't track a runner.
Oh, I know.
Or get a tackle in, honestly.
That is one wee issue at the moment. Obviously, they're struggling a bit. But there's so many games that they don't really have much time to do much work on the training field. And I think that helped certainly in the first half of the season that Tony Docherty managed to get a lot of coaching into his team. And he's not able to do that with these new players that have come in. There's four new faces in the building. And they're kind of learning on the job. They're not getting to train and speak to their new teammates that much because they're basically having one or two training days a week.
One thing I would say about that, from the days when Dundee liked a European player, the European players used to say, well, we used to have to walk through things in the afternoon. You don't have to run all the time. You can. One of the problems is the weather here, but Northern Italy, parts of Spain, is very wet in the winter as well. You can have players out in the pitch on an afternoon with their tracksuits on, showing them where to stand, walking them through stuff without sort of physical exertion. I mean, it was always news to me, but apparently some people work an eight-hour day.
You're still able to do drills and get into players, what they're doing, wrong. I'll go to Darek Costolo, I think it should be.
Darek
Costolo, the goal from...
Cross the goal on Tuesday.
Tony Docherty will you know, make him well aware of what he should be doing. But, I mean,
he did sell one up as well, though, to be fair.
I've got to say, remember...
it's a good play.
Yeah, I remember Owen Beck losing a similar goal against Johnson at Perth.
Owen Beck, and before we finish, Dundee, we'll touch on that briefly, but Owen Beck, great player. But he was another fullback that still had to learn to defend.
So they'll work on that. And as Tony Docherty says, you learn from your mistakes. It's when you do it continually that you're not going to be in the team. You'll be out and you'll not be back in that team. Because although they've made, they have a few boys out, they've still got a big squad there.
There is a big squad.
They've still got a big squad. So Tony Docherty will put boys in who are going to do the job for him.
Yeah. Afraid to rotate. No.
And we'll need to mention before we finish about Cammy Kerr, obviously.
Yeah,
there is a big squad, and they need to cut some players from it. Unfortunately, that it seems like it's going to be the end of Cammy Kerr's 10 years plus.
One of my sources in Tesco suggested Inverness.
That's been the link.
I think that's pretty much done.
You seem to spend a lot of time in Tesco, Tom Duthie.
Yes, I do.
That'd be sad. Interested one, Cammy Kerr and Duncan Ferguson together. Obviously, Dundee links.
Gary Bolan. Mm-hmm. Now, you should remember this, but there is a link between Gary Bolan and Cammy Kerr. His daughter went to school with him because she did work experience. Very talented.
Oh, yeah,
she did work experience here.
That's right,
in a sports sense, I would add, she talked about Cammy a lot more than her dad. Yeah. I was thinking, your old man was actually a very good player. Did you know this? But she's like, I was at school with Cammy Kerr.
Right, yeah. You lived
in the same room. It's a boy that played in the Champions League. Yeah.
It'd just be strange to see him in a different shirt.
It would, but I think it's, you know what, it gets to a point where it's the best for all concerned. Cammy Kerr doesn't...
He's not going to play.
He's not going to be playing games. He's too good a player. He's at a good age. He's fit. What's not to like about Cammy Kerr? I would suggest that, you know, that there'll be more than Inverness interested in Cammy Kerr. He's a good, honest professional. He's a good defender. All right, he's got limitations going forward, but as a defender, he's one of the best.
I was going to say, Bear, I would suggest that Cammy Kerr's coming to the end of his Dundee days, but I would be more than happy to see that in the summer because it's about consolidation just now and don't shore up the defence, don't give away goals.
Yeah.
And he's very good, very strong defensively.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it looks like Dundee United will probably face Zach Rudden at some point. Before the end of the season, looks like the entire championship, apart from United, are after him. Yeah, as I pointed out in the group chat, that's very audacious for some of the teams at the bottom. Yes. With the best will in the world, I'm not sure Zach's going to a Broth. But he'll be
Fielders can't afford them.
I think it'll be a fine asset for anyone in the Championship. Yeah, he's quite clearly a proven Championship attacker, and he'll bring physicality, energy, ability to hold the ball up at Championship level. To most teams in that division, so I would expect at some point Declan Gallagher and Kevin Holt to have a right old rammy with him at some point. But it'll be interesting to see where he ends up. I don't know. Maybe I would suggest maybe if they can afford a sufficient chunk of his wages, I would suspect Dunfermline might be a good fit because obviously you've got the James McPake factor, I should say, and also that guaranteed that he'll probably play every week and be the focal point of that team. Mm. Whereas if he goes to Raith Rovers, you've got a very capable Jack Hamilton who you're going to have to battle with for a starting spot. So I think Dunfermline could make a great deal of sense for him.
It was a little bit of a surprise though, because he had started a lot of games.
I know. Obviously, you'd be far more able to explain that than me. But I was a wee bit surprised by that when you look at how many games he's played.
Yeah, I think
Charlie Riley's looked good in his games. That might be a factor.
Yeah. Well, I think it's just Curtis Main coming in has just pushed, run down the pecking order, and I think they maybe stretched the budget a bit to get Curtis Main in, so they need to
free
make that
up
back
a bit.
And they've got five strikers with Main coming in and possibly Michael Mellon.
We'll
see. Andy Robertson was on the bench.
Yeah, he was on the bench, and Simicass is supposed to be near. Mm-hmm. And Liverpool very kindly put Beck on at Bournemouth last. God, great team, Liverpool.
He did well.
So that nobody else could use him. But I mean, George and I, being a bit anarchy, we looked at the rules, didn't we, George? And you can actually separately. you mentioned you'd done it too. We never speak to each other apart from this.
It was Bear was thinking that somebody else might sign him.
Yeah. No, but there's the strange rule that you can sign for three different clubs in one season, but you can only play for two of them.
Dundee fans will be hoping desperately that might help. I'm not sure if Owen Beck comes back. I'm not sure where that leaves Owen Dodgson and
well, Dodgson's shown he can play inside.
Ryan Ashley and you know, what's the other big defender that we don't have on the
Portales.
No,
Lamy.
On the other side.
Donnelly.
Where did it all fit into this team?
I think if you can get back, you'd take him back, don't you? You can never have too many good players.
Yeah,
if
you can afford to take him.
Yeah, I think
that's for Donny Docherty to worry about.
I'm sure he could make the argument.
Do you know that I'm so sad that I even looked back to when Zach Robinson went back to Wimbledon last season to see if you played for your parent club when the loan was cancelled. Were you allowed to then be loaned out again to the same? And he had 5 minutes for Wimbledon.
It was a year ago. Yeah,
and then so Beck's allowed to come back if Jürgen. If you want him to come back. And having watched that game last Sunday, luckily he played at Bournemouth. Is there a more boring stadium? It's not like he's going to say, the atmosphere down here.
Tom, I watched that game and I was delighted to see Owen Beck coming on for obvious reasons. And then he had the ball and there was a wee passage of play in the middle of the park, and next thing I saw him sprinting through the middle of the at centre forward, and that is just Owen Beck. And I thought, Owen, you'll get away with that at Dundee, but I can't see you getting away for too long at Liverpool, I've got to say. But full of energy.
I thought he did well. He kicked off the move that ended up in a goal, which I think
full of energy.
You can see that.
Who cares what he did? Just the fact he was on the park is giving us hope.
You'd hear the seethe over in the west. The old fan fans, oh no!
Liverpool hate us now.